Many people aren't happy to be back from fall break, but I'm very happy to be back here. Right, Adrian? Adrian.
Yes, I'm so glad to be back.
Welcome back to the Westfield Sports Show, and in case you have forgotten, we are your hosts, Rowan and Adrian.
Hopefully you haven't forgotten that Westfield football has a sectional battle at Carmel this Friday. We will obviously talk about that. Coach Gilbert will also talk about this matchup.
Now, right before we went on break, we had Westfield football traveling to Franklin Central for the regular season finale.
Things started out with a Cato June interception, but Westfield was unable to capitalize off of it. Former Shamrock Nevin Tedero found William McKinley in the end zone for FC, but the PAT was blocked, making it 6-0. Flash's lead with 6 minutes left in the first.
After both teams traded turnovers, it was Brock Stewart getting in on the action for your Shammies. Franklin Central scored again with 5 minutes left in the half, but the two-point attempt was no good.
But with 3 minutes and 29 seconds left in the half, Jackson Gilbert found Brock Parker to make it 12-7 going into halftime.
But then Jackson Gilbert found Max Nosler on a huge 81-yard play to open the half, giving the Shamrocks a 14-12 lead.
After that, Liam Butler recovered a fumble, which led to Jackson Gilbert finding Gabe Arambolas to make it 21-12 Rocks, with 3 minutes left in the third quarter.
Unfortunately, William McKinley struck again, making it 21-19 with 10:14 left. But after FC got the ball back, Andrew Liske punched the ball out, but it resulted in a three and out. But after Westfield got the ball back, Jackson Gilbert connects with Kendall Garnett 60 yards all the way to the house. Good night, Franklin Central.
Here is Jackson and Kendall to talk about this play on this edition of Detail.
All right, Jackson. All right, Kendall, tell us what you saw and how you executed.
To be honest, I just saw an open shot when Jackson threw it up in the air. That play was basically designated for me to get, and I received the ball, and all I was thinking was I got to get a touchdown because that was going to be my first touchdown of, like, that game. It was a pretty hard start for me from the start of the half. But I just had to finish the half out with that good old 60-yard touchdown pass.
Cool, and this week, Carmel, you absolutely dominated them last year. What is your plan to do it again this year?
Just be plus one. Do better than what I did last year. I rushed for like 250 yards that game, so I'm thinking I rush for more than that. I'm planning on scoring like four touchdowns that game like last time. I'm feeling good. I think that we'll go out there and we handle business.
Now, I know your team is confident, but is there any kind of pressure that you feel?
So they created a video, kind of like a motivation video for them, I guess. Kind of gave us a little bit of motivation because they have been posting stuff about us. So, you know, we're just going to go out there and use that, you know, as an advantage, you know, go out there and kick their butts.
Yeah, I think they posted one of your TikToks.
Yeah, they posted that TikTok, but it's okay, though. I'm going to prove to them that, hey, I'm the best running back.
Hey, man. Thank you, Kendall.
Thank you.
And tell us what you saw and how you executed.
Yeah, so on that play, the coverage they were in, we thought we could potentially sneak the running back down the sideline and they would leave him uncovered because they were getting our receivers pretty locked down. And so we tried a fake toss to him and then we booted away from him. And then when he ran down the sideline, we were correct. Nobody ran with him. All I had to do was place it over his shoulder. He just caught it, took it down the sideline, and that was that 60-yard touchdown.
And now I have to talk about Carmel this week. Obviously, your team is very confident, but also, is there any kind of pressure on you?
Well, if you consider, you know, everything we've worked for and our goal of winning the state championship pressure, then I guess, yeah. But like you said, we're super confident. We have no doubts that we have everything we need to go out there and just kill them, and we just want to do that so bad.
Yeah, thank you. And also, it seems like it's a weekly basis we're talking to you about a big play you make. So keep making big plays, and yeah, let's beat Carmel.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, guys. To end this game, Thomas Vandergriff gets the interception, and that was your ball game. Westfield wins 28-19 and finishes the regular season with only one loss.
What was really important about this game, though, was this was Coach Gilbert's 100th win as a Shamrock. Congratulations, coach. And I talked to him about that and the upcoming sectional matchup against Carmel. All right, coach. Carmel, very familiar opponent coming up. I guess just what's the mindset going into this game, knowing that you beat them last year?
Well, it's a new year, so I would say it's new, but obviously they're going to be pretty hungry considering we knocked them out last year. We would be. So each team's its own team. We have our challenges for this year that we're working on, but we know that we're going to play a motivated Carmel team Friday, but we'll be pretty motivated too.
On a completely unrelated note, I do want to congratulate you on your 100th win as a Shamrock last week. Did you have that mind, did you have that milestone in mind going into that game, or did you treat it like it was any other game?
Well, I didn't even know about it until I read about it in the newspaper on Friday, so it wasn't in my mindset. I appreciate it, though. It is a big honor to have been here this long, and so just pretty pleased with the opportunity to be here that long, win that many games, for everyone who's contributed to that, so thank you.
And finally, this Carmel team, a team with a lot of ups and downs. What makes Carmel different from any opponent you've played this year?
Well, they're huge up front, and their defense is a little bit of a different style. Just kind of the way they play the 3-4 is different. And then they have a great player. They've got a two-way guy named Peterson who's going to IU in first corner. Yeah, he's excellent. So he's pretty unique in how good he is as a DB, but then also can crease you as a returner or on offense. Mm-hmm. So.
All right, thank you, Coach.
Go Rocks.
Thank you, Coach. And you heard that right. Carmel gets a shot at redemption this Friday against your Shamrocks. Here is Callie to preview this matchup.
I'm Callie Stigler, and this is a football preview. Westfield is playing Carmel at Carmel. Westfield finished their regular season with a win over Franklin Central 28-19 to make their record 8-1. On the other side, Carmel lost to Lawrence Central 21-17 to make their record 5-4. Carmel is looking for revenge for what happened last season.
Thank you, Callie. Now let's talk about volleyball and how their sectional run went as they took on Zionsville.
Session one saw Zionsville win 25-21, but your Shamrocks took home session two in dominating fashion as they won 25-10.
Westfield edged out Zionsville in session three with a score of 26-24, and Zionsville looked great in session four with a score of 25-14.
Unfortunately, Zionsville barely edged out Westfield in session 5, 15-13. The Lady Rocks had a great season despite their early exit.
They sure did, and they didn't go down without a fight. Chloe Sutake had an incredible farewell performance with 12 kills on 19 attacks.
Let's wrap up school sports with boys and girls cross country as they started sectionals. Let's start with the girls. They finished third in sectionals as a team, sparked by incredible individual performances from Liz Smith, who finished fifth, and Liv Lozier, who finished sixth.
Then came regionals last Saturday at Shelbyville. Your Lady Rocks needed to finish top five to make it to state, and they finished fourth. Liz Smith finished fourth individually, and Liv Lozier finished 10th. Your Lady Rocks are headed to Terre Haute this Saturday for the state meet.
Let's talk about the boys. They just barely survived sectionals by finishing fifth, which meant they were able to live another day in regionals. But their luck ran out as they finished 15th in regionals as a team. It was a good season for your Rocks, though. We have a lot of national sports to discuss. Let's start with the MLB playoffs. On the day of this recording, the Rangers and Astros will play a pivotal game 7. The Astros battled back from a 0-2 deficit to take a 3-2 lead, but a 9-2 win for Texas tied things up. Adolis Garcia hit one of the coldest grand slams ever to put the game on ice in game 6.
Now let's talk about the NLCS. On the day of this recording, the Phillies and the Diamondbacks play a game 6 where Philadelphia looks to advance to the World Series for a second straight year. The Diamondbacks clawed their way back from an 0-2 deficit, but in game 5, the Phillies came out swinging. Kyle Schwarber and Bryce Harper homered. What's new?
We might actually get Phillies and Astros again.
This is actually the first Game 7 in a CS since 2020, where both the NLCS and the ALCS went to 7 games, and my Dodgers came out on top.
Yeah, but that was a Mickey Mouse ring. You do know that doesn't really count, right? Now it's that time of the year, time for the NBA.
Yes, I will give you my biggest sleeper right now, the Indiana Pacers. Tyrese Haliburton is the best playmaker in the league, and Benedict Mathurin and Obi Toppin will have breakout seasons. This is definitely the most excited I've been for the Pacers in a long time.
Here's Drew Taylor with the NBA preview.
The NBA season is upon us. Let's discuss it. Well, first off, some of the more notable moves this offseason were the Trailblazers sending Dame Time to the Bucks, Drew Holiday to the Celtics, Chris Paul to the Warriors, and at the time we are recording this, really the bigger picture in the NBA here is the future of James Harden is still unclear. Many of you are Pacers fans. We'll talk about the hometown team, the Indiana Pacers. With the signing of Bruce Brown and Obi Toppin, they've got a young Benedict Mathurin and an all-star in Tyrese Halliburton, who just got a big payday. The Pacers find themselves in a very good spot. The only question surrounding this team is Buddy Hield. He could leave in free agency next offseason or could be traded. Hield shot more than 40% from the field for the third time in 7 seasons, so his presence is definitely felt in Indiana. But needless to say, this team is in a pretty good spot for this season, and I think they're going to be substantially better this year. I actually have a game tonight against the Wizards. Tune in on Bally Sports. Anyways, I have, for season predictions, I do have a repeat. I think the Nuggets will win the chip yet again with the Joker and Jamal Murray. I don't see anyone stopping this duo. That duo was on display last night against the LA Lakers. Played pretty well. Rookie of the year, I am kind of torn on this, believe it or not. And it's actually kind of a debate between Chet Holmgren and Victor Wembanyama. I think it's going to be Victor Wembanyama. Just all the hype is just definitely there. He came over from France, and I think he's, with his length, his ability, his skills, he's going to come in and dominate the league very quickly. And for Chet, he didn't have an official rookie season last year, so this is kind of his official rookie season. But he's definitely going to be a huge help for the Thunder. They already have a rising star in Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. The Thunder, they're going to be competing in the West, looking long-term down the road. I truly believe that. And for MVP, because these are the only two awards I'm doing as Rookie of the Year MVP, I have Jason Tatum. It's kind of a hot take, but at the same time, he's obviously one of the better scorers in the league, and I know that not just being a scorer wins MVP, but I believe since he's able to play off the ball so well and having Marcus Smart's departure, I actually think was for the best, Jason Tatum will win MVP. You heard it here first. And we'll stay on that topic. The Boston Celtics, I'm really high on them. If you want to know who I'm cav out of the East, Drew Holiday, with the addition of his defense, it's going to help them out a lot. Jaylen Brown, Jason Tatum, really good duo. And really their whole team, even the guys coming off the bench, it's pretty stacked up. So I have them and the Nuggets in the championship, and I have Denver winning, obviously. That is your 2023-24 NBA season preview. Thank you guys for watching. We got a lot of games coming up. It's gonna be a great season, long season, but it'll be fun. Thanks for watching.
Thank you, DT. Now let's end our show with some NFL talk. Well, let's talk about your Colts. Anthony Richardson is done for the year, and all I know is pain. While the Colts played the Browns, Jonathan Taylor returned to his original form with this touchdown. Then Gardner Minshew found Michael Pittman Jr. for a huge touchdown. But then after that, the Colts started playing against the refs. How's that PI? Tell me. Browns win, and for the last time, an uncatchable throw is not PI.
Let's talk about Atlanta and Tampa Bay. With 45 seconds left, Chase McLaughlin tied it for the Bucs, making it 13-13, but the Falcons drove all the way down the field and led to Young Hoku, 51-yarder, to win it for the Falcons.
Let's end our show with the Bills and Patriots. The Bills rally back from being down 22-10 and take a 25-22 lead with 2 minutes left, but Ramondre Stevenson put New England in position to win the game on a 1-yard Mike Gesicki touchdown. Worst gritty ever, but the Patriots win. Well, that's our show. Here's the upcoming schedule for Rock Sports.
Stay humble and go Rocks.